Well, welcome back, folks, to our journey through the sound of our youth, hopefully, 1950s and 60s, at least my youth. I know I'm just a kid compared to some. I've always said I think I live in the only place in the world you could be 76 and be called a kid. But we have been listening to the popular music of the 1950s and 60s and talking about the songs and the songwriters and the singers, and I don't know about you, but I'm just having a great time. So let's bring it in with a little bit of that music. Okay, so we always do a trivia question to begin our show. 1959, that's the year we've been on, and we're going to finish up hopefully today, saw George Jones, who would become one of country music's biggest stars, record his first number one hit. What was the name of the song? Well, it was White Lightning. 1959 saw George Jones record his first number one hit, written by J.P. Richardson, the man that we called the Big Bopper, who was one of the three that was killed in a plane crash on what became known as the Day the Music Died. The song would hit number one on the country charts, become the fourth best-selling country song of 1959, and would propel George Jones into a career which would make him an absolute superstar. So let's listen to George Jones sing White Lightning. This is from 1959.
Jug and he'd pass it around. Body, mighty fizz and pappy stones.
Shh, White Lightning.
Well, the G-Man team in the revenues too, searching for a place where he made it through. They were looking, trying to look him, but my pappy never grew.
Shh, ooh, White Lightning.
Turned blue. Lightning started flashing. Thunder started flashing.
Shh. White Lightning.
Well, G-Man team in the revenues too, searching for a place where he made it through. They were looking, trying to hook him, but my pappy never knew.
Shh. White Lightning.
As he hit the ground, mighty, mighty please, and your Baptist horn screams.
Shoo, White Lightning.
Well, G-Man, the revenue's too, searching for a place where he made it through. They were looking, trying to boogie, but my Baptist never grew.
Shoo, White Lightning.
Oh, Okay, so there is George Jones singing the Big Boppers, White Lightning, his first big hit. Well, let's kind of review what we talked about last week. Last week, we saw that in the era of good music, it was not such good music for the most part. But then we looked at some of the rhythm and blues and the soul artists, and they actually had some very good music come out of 1959. The Isley Brothers had their terrific up-tempo song called Shout. We then listened to Flamingos sing their number one hit, I Only Have Eyes for You. We saw how Ray Charles took a really big leap forward with his song What I Say, which would become one of the most recorded songs of the decade and establish Charles as the leader of the new soul music, which was kind of a fused gospel and R&B blend together. We saw the Drifters come into being. The Drifters probably became probably the best of all the vocal groups of the late 1950s, mid-1960s. They had just a string of unbelievable hits. The first one was in 1959 with There Goes My Baby, and made them, like I said, one of the most successful groups of the era. And then we finally listened to The Crest sing their song 16 Candles, which kind of it kind of captured the mood of the 1950s, and kind of, you know, a lot of kids listened to that because it kind of a romantic ballad as such. Well, I thought we would play one of those songs that kind of was the epitome of what the record producers were trying to achieve in 1959. Remember, it was their goal as a group, not every one of them, but for most of them, to kind of get away from the rock and roll of Elvis and Fats Domino and Jerry Lee and Chuck Berry and, you know, some of these guys like this. They wanted to bring us back to what they called good music. One of those groups that they found was out in Olympia, Washington, called the Fleetwoods. It was actually three high school kids. And they had a number one hit with this song and actually became one of the best-selling songs of the year. And really unique. It's extremely calm. In fact, the case that they almost whispered it, which was kind of a trademark of this group. So let's listen to Come Softly to Me by the Fleetwoods.
How many records do you have?
About 75.
I wouldn't be the least bit surprised if you didn't have this one in your collection, or maybe you were about to add it. It's one of the fastest selling records in the country called Come Softly to Me. Ladies and gentlemen, here the Fleetwoods.
Dum, 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 softly, darling, come to me, stay on my obsession forever and a day.
I want you to know I love you so. Please hold me so tight.
Okay, so that was the Fleetwood Come Softly to Me, about as far away from Elvis and Jerry Lee as you could get, right? Well, there were several events that took place at the end of 1959, which kind of symbolized this movement away from this icons of rock and roll that we've been talking about for a while. Prior to the 1950s, records that got played on the air was determined almost exclusively by the disc jockey. If you wanted a record played on the disc jockey, on the radio, you pretty much had to leave it up to the DJ to play it. Here was the problem. There was kind of an under-the-table system of gratuities that had been set up where the record producers would give favors to the disc jockey. It became known as payola. Technically, it was not illegal, particularly if you used a third-party promoter, which is exactly the system they set up. The problem was, as there was a lot of these smaller independent labels come into being instead of the big three that had always been there, the big producers were kind of challenged to up the ante. In other words, pay more money to get their songs played. And that was how how your record got sold. So they began to try to figure out some ways to combat this. One of the ways they came up with was something called Top 40 formatting. Now, this originated out in Omaha, Nebraska, by a disc jockey by the name of Todd Storrs. He's the one that's the most generally accredited with starting the Top 40 programming. And he hit upon an idea. He said that as he would get done with his late night show, he would go across the street to a cafe that usually by that time he was about the only person there. And he noticed that as the waitresses and the help would start cleaning up, they would put the jukebox on and they would play the same songs over and over and over. And he finally asked me, he said, why don't you change the songs around? And they said, well, we'd like to hear these songs. We don't care if we've heard them before. And it dawned on him, people want to hear the same songs. And so he came up with the idea of just having a show where the top 40 show records of that week would be played. And that's all, no more. It took the kind of the eventually it became known as formatting, Formula Radio, and it took the power of the DJs where they could no longer determine what records were going to be played. So it didn't matter if they got paid or not. And that became the big format of most radio shows that play music, still that way. And so you had people like this, Casey Kasem. I bet some of you remember listening to Casey Kasem's Top 40 in the 80s. I can remember it, even though I was, not a kid by then. I can remember it because my daughter listened to it. And so, I would end up hearing some of it on the radio. So all this kind of ended the system of payola, but it didn't come without some grief. One of the effects of the growth of the Top 40 was taking the program authority out of the hands of the disc jockeys. This was this dirty little secret. Everybody knew it was happening. I mean, it was not a it it was nothing that was secretive. It was kind of under the table and nobody talked much about it. But technically, it was not illegal because they used third-party promoters. In other words, they would hire somebody to go out and promote their records to the radio stations. And if they paid money to the disc jockeys, then the record companies didn't do it. Of course, the record companies would reimburse them under the table. We know how that worked. However, more and more small record companies began to challenge the traditional powers of Capitol, Decca, Columbia, RCA. They didn't really need to pay to play. And so they decided they had to get rid of this payola. And they decided the best way to get rid of it was to expose it. They just said, hey, we're gonna spill the beans. We're gonna make a big deal out of it. Congress helped them because they had just got done going through a big 2-year investigation of TV quiz shows. I bet some of you remember this. You remember the $64,000 questions in 21, where it turned out that the quiz shows were giving their people, the contestants, the questions and answers. It all came about when a guy by the name of Herb Stemple kind of spilled the beans, because he had been paid to lose because they didn't think he was telegenic enough. They wanted someone a little bit different, and the person they chose was a guy by the name of Mark Van Doren, who was from he was a college professor, and his father was a Pulitzer Prize, a Pulitzer winning biographer. And so they decided that they wanted him to be the champion instead of Stemple. Stemple got mad and spilled the beans. The result was that all this quiz show thing came to a head. Well, after that was settled, Congress turned their attention to payola, because again, the record companies, the big record companies, decided they were going to spill the beans, so they would have to stop paying all this under the table money to the record disc jockeys. The whole investigation kind of centered on the two biggest names in popular music, Alan Freed, who had coined the term rock and roll and had been a force in rock and roll from the very beginning, and Dick Clark, who, of course, ran American Bandstand. And those two were called before Congress to give testimony about payola. The problem is you couldn't have had any different reactions, okay? Before the scandal broke in public, ABC had found out what was going on. And they ordered Clark, they said, hey, you got to divest yourself of all of the ownership of all these music-related businesses. He was in just almost like a pyramid scheme. And on top of that, he had legitimately never taken payola. His people had given payola, but he had never taken it. When he got up before Congress, he was this clean-cut, very polite, cooperative witnesses. And, you know, he just wanted, you know, he just did not come across as being a crook. Well, Alan Freed then come up before Congress, and Freed was as different from Clark as he could be. He was abrasive, he was combative, he was non-penitent. He didn't, you know, he didn't act like he was, you know, sorry for anything. And the result was that all the bricks fell on Freed. Clark got away with it without any kind of problem at all. And Freed became the poster child for payola. The result was he was later on arrested and tried, convicted of commercial bribery, conflict of interest, income tax evasion, none of it associated with payola, but as offshoots of the payola. In the end, he only received a fine, suspended sentence, but his career was over. And he died within a few years, just, you know, a broken man. Clark, of course, went on to become one of the giants of music in the 20th century. I thought you might be interested in this. This is a short 3-minute segment of Dick Clark discussing the payola scandal. This was, I believe, in the early 2000s, and he is discussing the whole payola scandal, and it's pretty enlightening. So why don't we take about 3 minutes and listen to this.
At that moment in time, the world realized that kids might rule the world. They had their own music, their own fashion, their own money. Aha! All of a sudden, they came in. Bandstand was a hit maker because radio disc jockeys would listen, program directors listen to it and say, we better be playing that. So simultaneously, several hundred radio stations and the most important kid television station all played the same music. At that point, and it has been the case since time immemorial, you can bribe people to play your goods. In the old days, piano players in the Woolworth stores would get a $5 bill to play the sheet music so the customers would buy. Television, radio came along, payola came up. Disc jockeys would play records for pay. It was well known. I never took any money to play records. I made money other ways. Since I only got $1,500 a week to produce 7.5 hours of television from ABC, I went into the music business. I was a manager of artists, a publisher of music, a manufacturer of recordings, horizontally, vertically, every single way you can think of, I made money from that show. One day a man offered me a $100 bill to play a record, and I asked him to leave. It's the only time anybody ever tried to bribe me. people who worked for my record company were commissioned to pay disc jockeys to play records. It was normal. It was legal. We declared it. It was not illegal at that point. It became illegal in early 1960s when the Congress said, no more of this. It's against the law. You've broken the law. You can't do it. Still goes on to this day, except it isn't as blatant. It's much more subtle. I was dragged to Washington in 1959 or 60. They broke into my house. They tapped my phones. I found out that Big Brother's not always the good guy. I was raised in the Eisenhower era. It was a very illuminating experience. During the height of all of this, and they were really, it's not very interesting now because you know the government is crooked. You know that. You know politicians are not straight. We didn't know that then. I was invited to Walter Annenberg's house to a birthday party for one of his children at the height of the Piola investigations. He drew me aside. He was not the ambassador then, but the ambassador said to me, is there anything you haven't told us? Is there anything that they could uncover? I told them everything. I kept all the records, showed them all the records, all the things I had interest in. I was just, why not? I wasn't doing anything wrong. I was an entrepreneur. He said, is there anything that we need to know? I said, sir, I have told you everything. I haven't done anything I'm ashamed of. I hope I can live through this. He put his arm around me, and I'll never forget. He said, I don't know what you call my son or my boy, but he said, he indicated he was older than I, and he was in his 40s then. I looked up to him as an older guy. I reminded him about the other day when I thought he was real old at 40. He said to me, don't worry about this if that's true. They're going to put you in a giant crucible. They're going to boil you in oil, but you'll come out harder and smarter, and you will survive. And that's exactly what I was able to do.
So that's quite interesting. You know, he's very honest and forthright about the whole Paola scandal thing. Well, there's one more big event that occurred in 1959 that really signaled the end of the old icons of rock and roll. Of course, Elvis is in the Army. Fats Domino is sitting down in New Orleans, kind of semi-retired. Little Richard has joined the ministry. Jerry Lee Lewis was totally done because he'd married his 13-year-old cousin. Pat Boone had switched to crooning. The old icons were all gone except for Chuck Berry. He was still out there recording songs and having big hits, and the kids loved him. Chuck Berry got in quite a bit of trouble towards the end of 1959. So here's what happened. They decided they were going to make him the poster boy for the opponents of rock and roll. Chuck Berry was never one of these kind to go softly into the night, to kind of plagiarize the Fleetwood there. During the tour of the Southwest in 1959, Berry had met a young Apache girl working as a bartender in Juarez. And according to Berry, he asked her how old she was, and she said she was 21, and that she was being abused physically and sexually. Now, Berry says he offered her a job. He said, if you'll come back with me, I'll dress you up in an Indian costume, and you can, kind of be the hat check girl at my new bar that I'm opening up, and, it'll be quite the event. She says no. What he offered her was sex, Well, that's, we're never going to know the whole thing because it's a he said, she said thing. So he took her with him back to St. Louis, young girl by the name of Janice Escalante, who he says he thought she was 21. Okay. Once back in St. Louis, things went downhill real fast. She began stealing from the customers. She began reverting back to her old lifestyle of prostitution. She began taking drugs again. And he said, hey, I can't have this because I'm going to get in trouble. So I'm going to send you back to Juarez. Well, she got upset and decided she didn't want to go back to Juarez. So she called the police in St. Louis and said, hey, Chuck Berry's been abusing me sexually, and I'm only 14, which is what she was. I'll show you a picture of her here in a minute, and you can make up your own mind, okay? Berry was arrested, charged on federal trafficking charges under the Little Used Man Act. He was convicted and jailed, but then he was released because he got granted a retrial because the judge had used so many racist comments during the trial that another court, a higher court, said, no, you didn't get a fair trial. You need to have another trial. So he had a second trial. They convicted him. He went on ahead and served 2 years of his 5-year sentence, most of them ironically here in Springfield, Missouri, at the Federal Medical Center. After his release, Barry's star in 1963 was gone. You know, he never had another successful recording session to mount anything. Now, he continued to go out and perform at live concerts and became just a really fabulous concert draw, particularly as he got older. He just died just about a year ago, and he was only in his 90s, and he was still singing every month at Blueberry Hill in St. Louis right before he died. So here's a picture of Chuck Berry. This is Janice Escalante at 14, the girl there to the right, and that's the lady that was supposedly the manager of the nightclub, and this is a picture they had taken. I don't know about you, but she doesn't appear to be 14 to me. She is 14 at that time, but, you know, anyway, that kind of ended Chuck Berry's career as such, as a recording artist. Now, it's really ironic. This was the last big hit he had as a recording artist. It was released right before he went to prison. It was called Sweet Little 16. Kind of ironic, given the circumstances. So let's listen to Chuck Berry's last big recording hit.
Let's turn him loose. Ladies and gentlemen, Chuck Berry, Sweet Little 16.
They really rock it in Boston and Pittsburgh, PA.
Okay, let's jump ahead. 1963, Chuck Berry gets out of prison here in Springfield, Missouri, Federal Medical Center. He gets in the car, and I'm sure one of the first things he did was ask his chauffeur, whoever it was, driver, say, hey, turn the radio on, man. I want to just sit back and let the air hit me in the face, and I've been in prison, and I want to hear some music. So he turns it on, and what do you think he hears? He hears the Beach Boys singing their first number one hit. And he has to look over at his driver and says, that's my song. They're singing my song. Because they were. Let's listen to the Beach Boys' number one hit in 1963, Surfing USA. Okay, I don't want to do any more there because we're going to be talking a lot about the Beach Boys, but I want you to hear that because, you know, later on, Chuck Berry sues the Beach Boys. He says, hey, you stole my song. You know, that's all there is to it. And there wasn't even a court because they settled out of court because it was so obvious that, you know, the Beach Boys had just taken Sweet Little 16 and changed the words and made it Surfin' USA. So now if you buy a copy of Surfin' USA, the author is listed as Chuck Berry because that was one of the settlements. And of course, his estate now gets all the royalties off that song. Well, let's go to country music because we need to talk a little bit about country music. The biggest songs in country music for 1959 were the following. El Paso was number one by Marty Robbins. Number two was Take Your Guns to Town by Johnny Cash. Lefty Frizzell had the number three song, Long Black Veil. George Jones had White Lightning, we just heard. Johnny Horton had Waterloo. Farron Young, Country Girl. Number seven, I Ain't Never by Webb Pierce. Number eight, There's a Big Wheel, Willman's Tony Cooper. Number nine, Under Your Spell Again by Buck Owens. And Ray Price's Heartaches by the Number. So, let's look at two of these songs here because they were the two really big songs that came out of 1959 that people remember. The first one was Johnny Horton and the Battle of New Orleans. It's not listed there because it actually ended up being a big pop song. It was actually the number one selling song across all charts in 1959. And it just goes to show that if you think you got everything figured out, you don't have it figured out in music. Because nobody could have predicted that this song would have been the number one selling song across all charts in 1959. Johnny Horton was a traditional music, country music singer, raised in East Texas, went to California, got college educated. Then he decided to go to Alaska on the gold prospecting scheme, which probably played into his later song, North to Alaska. Returned to the lower 48 states. To Texas, started appearing nightly on the Louisiana Hayride. He met Hank Williams' widow, and so they got married. So he got married into country music royalty. She said, hey, we need to go to Nashville. You're going to be a big star. I can help you become a big star. They went to Nashville and kind of struggled a little bit, and then a guy by the name of Jimmy Driftwood from a little town of Timbo, Arkansas, north of Mountain View, Arkansas, gave him a record that he had written clear back in the 30s called The Battle of New Orleans. And he said, I think you'd be really good at singing this. And apparently he was, because like I said, it became the number one selling record of all of 1959. Kind of a history-inspired song. And he went on ahead and made a whole string of these. Waterloo, sink the Bismarck north to Alaska. The last two became theme songs for movies. Johnny Horton was on top of the world in the early 60s. Unfortunately, we're never going to know if this was just a fluke or if they really were something that kind of hit a chord. Because on the night of November 4th, in 1961, two of his band members and him were traveling from Austin to Shreveport, got involved in an automobile accident, and he was killed. Story goes that Johnny Cash wrote in his biography that Johnny Cash was one of his very best friends. He said he locked himself in the hotel bar room and cried and drank himself till he passed out. He was so upset. So let's listen to Johnny Horton sing the biggest song of 1959, the Battle of New Orleans. Okay, so that's that. Now, got one more song I want you to hear. Marty Robbins had been around in country music for some time. He was originally raised in Phoenix, Arizona. He was an Okie. His parents had moved there during the Great Depression, and he had basically been raised by his mother and his grandfather, who actually had lived in the Old West, and he grew up listening to tales of the Old West. And he absolutely loved cowboy stuff. After World War II, he started singing in nightclubs, was heard by the little Jimmy Dickens. And he said, hey, you gotta come to Nashville. I can make a star out of you. You're a good singer. And so he came to Nashville and got himself a contract with Columbia Records, joined the Grand Ole Opry, and just had a fantastic career. Had 94 chart-topping records in his career, 16 of them reaching number one. That's quite a record, folks. What was unique about Robbins' career was that it was really diverse. He sung across several different genres. He began kind of as a rockabilly singer. He sang singing the blues. You might remember White Sport Coat and a Pink Carnation. And then he kind of moved into the Nashville sound. You Gave Me a Mountain and my woman and my wife. And then he kind of switched over to Western. He went back to his roots, and he produced an album in 1959 called Gunfighter Ballads and Trail Songs. And, you know, that album plus the big song in it, El Paso, became won a Grammy Award for Best Song of the Year and Best Album of the Year in Country Music. In 1971, he was voted Man of the Decades by Academy of Country Music. That's quite an accomplishment, folks. He was just a really almost like a Renaissance man. On top of that, he was a NASCAR racer, okay? And he was a pretty good NASCAR racer. I followed NASCAR for many years, and Martin Robbins ran it amidst some of the big tracks. Unfortunately, he died very early in 1957. He underwent open bypass surgery. And at that time, it was still kind of new and hadn't been around for a long time, had some complications and died. He had just been inducted into Country Music Hall of Fame 8 weeks before his death. Still a young man at 57. So let's listen to Marty Robbins' great song, which people still listen to today, El Paso.
Out in the West Texas town of El Paso, I fell in love with a Mexican girl. Nighttime would find me in Rose's Cantina. Music would play and Tonino whirl. Blacker than night were the eyes of Felina, wicked and evil while casting a spell. My love was deep for this Mexican maiden. I was in love, but in vain I could tell. One night a wild young cowboy came in, wild as the West Texas wind. Dashing and daring, a drink he was sharing with wicked Felina, the girl that I love. So in anger, I challenged his right for the love of this maiden. Down with his hand for the gun that he wore. My challenge was answered in less than a heartbeat. A handsome young stranger lay dead on the floor. For a moment I stood there in silence, shocked for the foul evil deed I had done. Many thoughts raced through my mind as I stood there. I had but one chance and that was to run. Out through the back door of Roses I ran, out where the horses were tied. Like it could run, up on its back and away I did ride, just as fast as I could from the West Texas town of El Paso out to the badlands of New Mexico.
Back in El Paso my life would be worthless, everything's gone in life, nothing is left. It's been so long since I've seen a young maiden. My love is stronger than my fear of death. I saddled up and away I did go, riding alone in the dark.
Maybe tomorrow a bullet will find me. Tonight nothing's worse than this pain in my heart. And at last here I am on the hill overlooking El Paso. I can see Rose's Cantina below. My love is strong and it pushes me onward. Down up the hill to Felina I go. Something is dreadfully wrong for I feel a deep burning pain in my soul. I'm getting weary, unable to ride. But my love for Felina is strong, and I rise where I've fallen. Though I am weary, I can't stop to rest. I see the white puff of smoke from the rifle. I feel the bullet go deep in my chest. From out of nowhere, Felina has found me, kissing my cheek as she kneels by my side. Cradled by two loving arms that I'll die for. One little kiss and Felina, goodbye.
Okay, that's it for today. Next week, we're going to move into 1960. 1960 was the year of the twist. I'll bet you some of you gals and guys out there did the twist when you were younger. I tried to. Unfortunately, I wasn't very good at it. But anyway, next week, we'll start talking about 1960. Another year of good music. So, hope you've enjoyed it. We will see you next week. And until then, adios.